Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on local GovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
We're now in session. Mr. Turner, you have the honor.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, will you join me in prayer, please? Father God, we thank you for this day. We ask for your blessings upon those in crisis in the county, Lord, and we ask for your divine providence for those in western North Carolina and eastern Tennessee who are so affected, whose lives have been uprooted by the storm and the after effects thereof. And we pray for your, again, providence and guiding hand, and thank you for the men and women who are pouring their spirit and their funds and resources into that area. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you join me with the pledge?
Before we do the pledge, could we have just a moment of silence for all those in western North Carolina and those in need? Thank you.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to the agenda, I'm going to make a motion that we remove three items. The first is item 6C, the DOT. There's some issues with the deeds of easement, and we need to review those with DOT before we pass that. Item 6D, those are write-offs, mostly because of 10-year statute of limitations, and I think the tax individual that we need to talk to is not present, so we need to move that to our next meeting. And item 7B, that's the water and so forth for green level. We did not get enough bids to make a motion and approve those. So I move that we remove those three items from our agenda.
Second.
Any discussion?
Just one question. I remember that we designated $500,000 of ARP money for that. Help connect that for me. As far as, does that pay for the lines that you're talking about? Because I know they put a giant water tank in the ground out there for that kind of stuff. So how does that go together?
You are correct. Excuse me. There is $500,000 of the ARP funds for the water lines, mm-hmm. so that'll just be put on hold until we figure out how we're moving forward with that project without the three bids.
Okay. Does Green Level, are they responsible for anything, or is this totally county?
It's actually ACC.
Okay, but I know we seem to be talking about it. I'm just curious.
Yeah, it's an ACC project. We're helping support it through the funding of the water lines.
Okay, well, if we got any money into it, it's ours too, so to speak. It's not one person. So, okay, I'm good, John. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Those three items have been removed from our agenda. As to the remaining agenda, do we have a motion?
Motion to approve.
I'll second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes 5-8. Okay, public comments. I see zero.
Yes, zero.
We've got
the best public input we've had.
Chair Pace, I think we have a proclamation this morning, too.
Right.
That's exactly right. Okay. Scott Sullivan. It's good to see you again. Scott, I'm going to hand this to you and ask you to read it. This lady is head of the domestic violence program, and I guess you run
Family Justice Center.
Primarily or secondarily, everything out there.
Sure. Take that. All right. Good morning. I'm Sky Sullivan, Director of the Family Justice Center. We have some partners with us today for this proclamation for Domestic Violence Awareness Month. So October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month. In Alamance County, we have a coordinated effort of partners who come together to try to solve the problem of domestic violence, elder abuse, sexual assault, child abuse, and human trafficking. Without our partners, we could not be a success. So I'm going to call everyone up here one by one. I'm going to start with Chief Blackwelder with Elon PD, if you want to come stand. Don't know where. Chief Baker with Grand PD, Chief McKinney with Mebane PD, Susan Watson, Executive Director of Women's Resource Center, Paige Holloman, she is Chair of our Voices Committee, and also a partner on site with Orinoco Wellness, our mental health service provider, LaTanya Hall, Elder Abuse Services Coordinator. We have two interns with the Family Justice Center today. So Sydney Lissack, she's our undergraduate intern, and Haley Parker is our master's level intern. Executive Director of Family Abuse Services, Linda Bruton, and Miriam Torres, who is the Director of Housing. We're also gonna call up the sheriff. I didn't ask him ahead of time, but come on up. And Major David Sykes as well. And anyone else in the room who wants to stand up here with us. All right.
Just about empty the...
Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Whereas domestic violence is the willful intimidation, physical assault, battery, sexual assault, and or other abusive behavior as part of a systematic pattern of power and control perpetrated by one intimate partner against another. And whereas in the United States, 1 in 3 women and 1 in 10 men will experience sexual violence, physical violence, and or stalking by an intimate partner during their lifetime. And whereas domestic violence does not discriminate and is prevalent in every community. People of any race, age, gender, sexuality, religion, education level, nationality, or economic status can be a victim. Whereas in response to multiple murder suicides and the community issue of domestic violence, Family Abuse Services of Alamance County was incorporated in 1985 to serve victims and their children with vital safety services. And whereas only a coordinated community effort will put a stop to this heinous crime. The Family Justice Center of Alamance County opened its doors in 2010 and provides one-stop services for victims of interpersonal violence, including domestic violence, stalking, sexual assault, child abuse, human trafficking, and elder abuse. Under one roof, professionals from different disciplines, including law enforcement, social services, victim services, nonprofits, and other government organizations work together to provide consolidated and coordinated safety, legal, and social aid to individuals and families in need. The Family Justice Center and its partners have served over 1,000 victims more than 3,000 times so far in 2024. And whereas there have been 61 domestic violence homicides and 17 suicides in North Carolina so far in 2024, already surpassing the numbers from 2022 and 2023. Whereas Domestic Violence Awareness Month provides an excellent opportunity for citizens to learn more about preventing violence and to show support for the numerous organizations and individuals who provide critical advocacy and assistance to victims. And whereas Alamance County has a moral obligation to work to prevent domestic violence, address its brutal and destructive effects, and make ending domestic violence a local priority. And do I read your part too? Therefore, it's resolved that we, Alamance County Board of County Commissioners, do hereby proclaim October as Domestic Violence Awareness Month.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, Board, any discussion about this resolution? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And you know that's unanimous. I want to thank each and everyone for being here and all the work you're doing. Your interns, you've got a lot of work ahead of you.
Don't scare them away.
Scott, why are you wearing purple?
Purple is the color for Domestic Violence Awareness Month. So if you see folks with purple ribbons or purple on, that's to signify Domestic Violence Awareness Month.
Now see, the sheriff and I both thought we were wearing that because of East Carolina.
Don't insult me.
And he's not a uniform today.
Not after they played this weekend.
He looks like he's trying to wear Clemson orange. I'm not quite sure what he's doing.
I was not going to get into the Wake Forest winning and Carolina losing, but...
See, I don't care about any of y'all's teams. I went to NC State. Thank
there you.
You. I do also want to let the public know that on Tuesday, October 29th, we are having a vigil for those who have lost their lives to domestic violence outside of J.B. Allen Courthouse. It's from 6:30 to 7. We read all of the names of folks who have lost their lives, and I will definitely send out the flyer. This is a joint effort between Family Abuse Services and Family Justice Center just to honor those victims and their families. We have had some homicides in Alamance County, and so this year we're hoping the families will attend as well.
You want to repeat the date and time and location so in case it skipped by people online?
Yeah, I'm just really hoping I get the date right. I'm pretty sure it's Tuesday, October 29th at 6:30 J.B. Allen Courthouse. Oh, thank you. All my interns said yes. They helped me get
okay.
the flyer. So.
They know, right?
Yes. Excellent.
And we thank each and every one of you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
If you ever get a chance to go online to the North Carolina Coalition Against Domestic Violence, they show the list of names for every year for the entire state. And many times there are murder suicides that include children for domestic violence.
That's right.
So this is horrific, and it doesn't seem to ever stop. So thank you all for your commitment.
Thank you.
It's ugly business.
We next have the consent agenda, and remember we removed two items.
Motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Mr. Lashley did the second one. Any further comments? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Unanimous. Thank you. Guess who's next? Oh. Terry Johnson.
Jim, first, I'd like to ask you to excuse me for being in a knit shirt, but we're headed to the mountains after this, and I'll normally be in a suit and tie. I'm appearing for you today to talk to you about the situation with our new courts coming in, et cetera, what we're having to do at the sheriff's office, and that we are requesting 6 new bailiffs because it's going to take those bailiffs and to go over it. I have my lieutenant, which is over the courts. So many courts has been added since our staffing was the way it was, and I want to go over that right now with you. We could. Court operations as of January of 2024, we had 8 regular operating courts, and we have those courts listed there for you to look at. Okay. Court staffing 2024, 10 full-time sworn bailiffs, lieutenant, 2 sergeants, 7 deputies, 7 part-time sworn bailiffs. Staffing inadequate to allow vacation and different things, sick leave, et cetera, in 2024. But since that time, there have been several courts added. Now, court operations spring of 2024, we have 12 regular operating courts, additional magistrate courts, and H&I felony court. Staffing is inadequate now. We are having to pull people off the streets that's supposed to be out there investigating and patrolling the areas into the courts to cover the vacations, the sick time, the new courts, training, and et cetera. Proposed court operations for January 25 with the new courts that y'all have allowed to come into our county. 3 additional regular operating courts has been added. That's the new district court. We've got a new district court judge coming in, new drug court, and we have 1 additional H&I felony courts, which gives us 15 total regular operating courts, which means we are going to be short bailiffs. And the law requires the sheriff to have an officer in those courts. January 2024, operation 8 courts, almost doubling regular operating courts as of January 2025. And you say, well, why are you in here asking for this now, Sheriff? Because this takes us about 8 weeks to complete background investigations on new hirees. And you say, why does it take 8 weeks? Because we have polygraph, we have background in the community and friends, we have FMRT that has to do psychological, and they're behind in Winston where they have to go. So we want to be ready to staff these courts. Staffing severely will be inadequate if we do not. Impacts, safety and security, court personnel and judges. We have to protect these judges too. We have deputies meeting judges, carrying them into the courthouse for their protection. General public, we've had several outbreaks in the courthouse. I know of one recently over the young lady, Latino lady, was hit and run. We had to almost break up a big fight there. So we have got to have bailiffs and in-custody defendants. We have to go to our detention center with the courts all over the city of Graham. We have to have deputies taking those individuals into the courtrooms and stuff. We just can't say, hey, go to big courthouse in the square, we'll meet you over there. We can't do that. And it limits a lot of our ability to cover these courts if we do not have these. And I am responsible to keeping the judges, the DAs, and the public safe. Here's just some pictures of a day in the courthouse. Look at the people you see lined up there. And that's a small group at times, waiting to get into the courtrooms.
Sheriff,
yes, sir.
Why do we have the line out in the hallway? That's not a break or anything.
No, sir. That's not a break. They're trying to get into the courtrooms.
Is that traffic court or what?
That's all the courts as far as that's the first floor. Is that not?
That's the H&I felony court there.
H&I felony court. And that's a small number of what has been there. Right there. And at times, you know, like I say, we don't have enough bailiffs to handle what courts we're having now, much less when we add those other courts to the courthouses.
Which, again, emphasizes the need for the expansion of the courthouse itself.
Yes, sir. Y'all going to be adding more courtrooms, too. But these are courts that's going on right now as of January 2025, and we haven't even built the $37 million addition.
But this illustrates very graphically why we needed to do that expansion.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And maintain current full-time, part-time staffing. We use some part-time staffing because we have to. Add six additional full-time sworn bailiffs. We'll have self-sufficient courtroom operations, eliminate the need for assistance from other divisions within the sheriff's office. When we're taking people off the road and we're already short there, a lot of things can happen. Allow for supervisors to manage their employees. Our supervisors are winding up in the courtrooms and not able to work with the judge, what the judges need and stuff. They're in the courtrooms running the court at that point in time. Allow time for vacation, sick time, and training. These individuals have to go through training also. So right now we're substantially short, but we've been able to do it by bringing people off the street, officers off the street, to put them in the courtrooms. And if we don't have any more bailiffs, guess what? We ain't going to have no deputies on the street because we're going to bring them all in because the law says the sheriff has to provide an officer in the courtroom. I'd like to ask the lieutenant to come up and give you a little bit of the problems that we're encountering and why we're having to do what we're doing now.
Good morning.
So, Lieutenant McPherson, I'm over the court division for the sheriff. As of January of 24 this year, we was only running one small claims court, and that was on Wednesdays. Since then, they've changed to 4 days a week, and they've moved it over here to the annex building. So that opened up Wednesdays for courtroom B where they was having it. Well, then they started doing H&I felony courts periodically, say 5 to 6 weeks on Wednesdays. Come January of 25, the H&I felonies is going to the first, third, and fifth Wednesday of the month. And then courtroom B is runs all week long. They're converting the jury lounge into a courtroom, and that's where the small claims court's going to be Tuesday through Friday there. So they're in drug courts on Friday afternoons. I think it's the second and fourth Friday. They're adding that. And where I would take my two bailiffs, because usually on Fridays, courtroom B would sometimes get done by lunchtime. So I'd send them bailiffs to traffic court on the second and fourth Fridays. Well, I won't have that option because they're starting the drug court, so I have to keep them in that room. So I'll have to find some bailiffs for traffic court on those days. They're plugging holes, the available holes that there was. Come 2025, especially with the new judge, they're just plugging holes and adding courts. And my sergeant and myself are regularly in the courtrooms, running the courtrooms, because I think last week we brought 74 inmates over from the jail to court. And that leaves one bailiff in the courtroom when you're running to get so many people from the jail and bringing them over. And it's just a security issue when you have, you know, 200 on a docket and a courtroom is full, and it's just a big security issue on that front.
I'm asking for six bailiffs. Now, let me say this. The North Carolina Sheriff's Association is going to send a courtroom security team in here to analyze the courts in Alamance County. I'm telling you, if they come in here, you're going to find out probably, and they're coming, how much understaffed we are. I'm asking for six because I know we can make it work with six. If they come in and they say, okay, you're going to need 12, Superior Court judge is going to say, you're going to have to put 12 bailiffs in the court, 12 new bailiffs. And I'm trying to work to keep as short as we possibly can, but still do our job here. And
Mr. Turner, question.
I'll defer for the moment, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Ms. Thompson.
Yeah, I know. Has this problem been going on a while, just like shortages in detention, shortages in patrol? Is it just an overall issue, or all of a sudden, because there's talk of a new judge in addition, that you're seeing that you're going to need bigger staff to make sure you're ahead of this?
No, it's been going on. I took over as a lieutenant in December of last year, and that's when I started working, trying to work on needing more people, mm-hmm. because we were short then. And then it just magnified as the spring came and they started adding courts. It really magnified. We've been, I can only speak because that was December the 1st of last year, and we was short then.
When you say they, is that the clerk of court? That body of our government? They are adding on more?
Well, I'm assuming it's the clerk on. I'm not sure who adds the courts on, but okay. they're added on.
Okay.
Chief Justice adds or who adds?
Well, being law enforcement, mm-hmm. and we've seen that you've had a hard, not you, but mm-hmm. the whole overall picture has had a hard time with getting the detention center filled, mm-hmm. and then we hear patrol, and then we've $10,000 bonuses were given. Mm-hmm. Are you going to have to look at having that to get people to come in for bailiffs? Because I'm asking, are we to the point of being really solid when it comes to detention and patrol?
I can't answer that. That's more of a personnel.
Well, I mean, I know I've been told that, you know, we've had so many to want to apply. Apply,
yeah.
I don't mean that that's the right person, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But didn't we recently hire some other patrol people from other police departments?
Yeah, we've had... A matter of fact, I'm about going to be back before you today, too, to ask for 10 more people because we have hired 16, and I'll ask my personnel captain to come up here, but we
I'm
have
13. I'm
just
trying to show how this is all connected.
It is.
No matter what the title, it's law enforcement.
Yes, ma'am. You're right.
Good morning. The sign-on bonus is indeed working. In July 2024, we had 70 vacancies. Right now, we've hired 14 people using the hiring bonus, eight of them being detention and six being sworn. Right now, I have 14 people on my board for detention and one deputy. We're getting at least 35 to 40 applications a day. Some of them are through the NeoGov, some of them are walk-up, some of them are word-to-mouth. So our protocol is the sheriff does require, the background check is extensive. So it is requiring us now to come in on Saturdays and Sundays to be able to work as many people that are getting in. So when we pre-screen, we're looking at their experience, we look at their criminal history, they do have to pass a psychological. It is a lot of work. So the bonus is working to be able to get us the people to be able to work. Prehistorically, we weren't getting the interest that we're getting now. So with these six additional bailiffs, it would take require us to do some extra work. Hopefully, we're able to get some laterals with experience. That's always hopeful with us when we're talking about detention or patrol. But with detention, we are right now, of the 13 detention officers I have on my board, only one person is a lateral, which means they have experience. So the bonus is pretty much working for those who sometimes have no experience or corrections experience. So we just have, we had two new people start today. So that's what equals the 14. And so you all have approved for us to do 20 of the hard to fill. And so that's one thing the sheriff is gonna ask for today. When I have 13 people, detention officers and one deputy, we're gonna need to know if we can continue the sign-up bonus as well, because we have people pending and waiting and wanting. They are showing interest in the agency because of that.
Well, I know we don't discriminate if you are the lead detective in New York City or if you're just locally, and if they want to switch over to the sheriff's department, that includes that bonus, correct?
Yes, ma'am, it does.
Okay, so why not a bonus for these people?
That would be applicable.
So is this under this
not? Yes, ma'am.
So hiring a bailiff is going to include that $10,000 thing also?
Yes.
Okay, so this isn't a different topic?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Mr. Lashley.
Thank you for coming this morning, Sheriff. I do have a couple of questions.
Okay.
Do you know how much it's going to cost for the six additional bailiffs? Have you figured out what their average salary is going to be?
Yes, ma'am. The average salary, you can say probably 400 and some, 500,000. Maybe
six.
I thought that was a piece. If that was for one, I'd take my resume. Oh my gosh. Okay, that's it. Okay.
No, you're looking at that. I don't know what the benefits would be, but you're looking at starting salary of 55, right at 51,200 times six.
Okay. So it's roughly six, and then we have to add the benefits.
Right, the benefits, you're probably getting close to
$400,000. Yeah, probably getting close to
benefits and equipment, yeah.
Yeah.
And equipment and stuff, you're looking at probably $500,000.
Sure, do you have a number on
the numbers that we looked at previously for the six would get us about $450,000.
Yeah.
He's right, the annual salary is $51,395. Right.
You said $51,395?
Mm-hmm. And with the equipment and stuff, you're looking at probably $500,000.
And you intend to fill these positions outside?
Do I now?
You intend to fill these positions from outside rather than in-house?
I'm going to fill them any way we can.
Gotcha.
As long as they're quality people.
Sure. I appreciate that. Just to reiterate, these new hires would qualify for the $10,000?
Yes, sir.
I'm good for now.
Mr. Turner. Now, he said defer.
You want to go? I just had one question. Are we going to need to do a budget amendment to support this?
Yes.
Okay.
We haven't determined yet where you'd like the funds to come from, so we'll need to have that direction as well.
Okay.
Your turn.
All right. So... But to that point, Sheriff, these weren't requested in the budget. Was there a reason why we didn't ask for these in the budget time?
Yes, sir, because our budget was prepared, submitted prior to that. The budget was passed, and then all of a sudden, all these courtrooms started coming into play, and the new courthouse is coming into play. That's why.
if you bring somebody from in-house to the bailiff's position, under this proposal, you pay them 10 grand, but then to fill the position that was left, you got to pay 10 grand.
No, no. If okay. we bring someone in-house to this position, nothing goes to them except what they were getting before this brought in there.
Okay. How many, you've got seven part-time sworn bailiffs. How many full-time positions does that equal?
As far as bailiffs, six.
It'd be three and a half and 20 hours a week part-time.
I would love to be able to do away with some of these part-time positions, too, but I don't know that we'll be able to.
Well, one question I got about the numbers is we've got the slide where we're talking about three additional regular operating courts that we're adding, district court, new drug court, and one additional H&I felony court. But those are really covered by the same individual or one of the individuals. So you're not like really adding, those, you're going to have one additional hearing officer conducting an additional hearing every day. I guess, aren't we double counting? Aren't we triple counting one session of court, one additional session of court?
Drug court's only one day a week.
Right, but if you're having an additional, if you're having drug court one day a week, then you can't have H&I that week or that day, and you can't have, like, the new district court judge would be in the mix to cover one of those. So I'm wondering if we're overcounting.
Duplicating.
Say the drug court is on the second, will be on the second, fourth Friday afternoon.
Right.
So whoever the deputies are, the bailiffs are in that courtroom will stay in there.
Right.
That's when the same day we have traffic on Friday afternoon. So
right.
I'll have to have someone to cover that. And the H&I felonies, it'll be on the first, third, and fifth Wednesdays. And see, in the prior Wednesdays, there was another court, say the annex was running a court. So I'd send whoever the bailiffs are on Mondays and Tuesdays and the rest of the week, them bailiffs would be in another courtroom.
But in order to do that, you're going to have a district court judge handling that.
Yes.
So you can't have a district court judge that you're asking for at the same time, because that district court judge is doing something else.
There'll be five district court judges.
Yeah. I think we're overcounting, as I see it. Because you only have one more district court judge who can do either one of these three things, but it can't do all three of them at the same time.
No, he's not going to do all three at the same time.
So you wouldn't need another bailiff. You wouldn't need three bailiffs at the same time. You would just need one, as I see it. So I sort of want to get to the bottom of that. The Sheriff, we had 70 vacancies at the beginning of the year. How many do we have right now?
Right now, we currently have 56 total. We have 43 in detention and 12 sworn. We've hired 14 so far.
I think it's probably unlikely that in the next 6 months we're going to hire 56 people.
I do not want to take detention positions and make them bailiffs because I'll never get them back.
Well,
that has been my history.
What I was going to say is if we do that for 6 months and then the next budget cycle get them back, then it wouldn't affect this budget.
You may not be sitting here in the next budget cycle. Do you understand what I'm saying? Not being funny, but that's what I have to look at.
What kind of lapse salary is? Who knows what kind of lapse salary is currently existing within the sheriff's department to apply to these positions? Do we know that?
I will dig for that. Rebecca, do you have that handy?
I can.
I'm just wondering if we would have to have a budget amendment. We'd have to have a budget amendment to add people.
Yes.
But then the funding's a separate issue.
It depends on where we're taking the funding from.
Do you have any recommendations on that?
She does.
Okay.
J. just to clarify, Mr. Turner is running for a judgeship. If elected, he would leave this board, but he has two more years left on his term as a county commissioner. So if he's not elected, he has to suffer and be a county commissioner. On the other hand, he is elected, he'll be a district court judge, and then there'll be a substitute for him. Just clearing up the...
Well, right now, I'm wearing a county commissioner hat.
So as of the most recent payroll, we are projecting that the sheriff's division would go over budget. And we knew that was going to happen due to filling vacancies and these sign-on bonuses. However, we budget based on the sheriff's department as a whole. And so if you include the detention division, we are predicting that that will have almost $1 million in savings, which would offset that overage.
Salary.
Exactly.
That includes the $10,000 sign-on bonus?
At this point, it just is based on hiring trends as of right now. So they're hiring as they go. So if we continue to hire at that same rate for the rest of the fiscal year, yes, that would include it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I know some of the bailiffs are part-time, some are full-time. Of the bailiffs you currently have, how many are part-time and how many are full-time?
Including myself, there are 10 full-time. I have two sergeants, and we have 7 part-time. One of them's retiring at the end of this year, so that leaves 6, and maybe 2 is retiring. I found out this morning, possibly 2 is retiring.
As I understand it, the part-timers would not receive the $10,000 signing bonus. Is that correct?
No, part-time don't.
I don't think we offer the part-time. It's just full-time positions.
That's my understanding.
Yeah, no, part-times do not receive no signing bonus.
All right.
And I would like to possibly cut down on the part-time by the using the full-time.
If you replace a part-timer with a full-timer, will you need them, and can you assign them to other duties when court is not in session?
Absolutely. Right now, we have lieutenant supervisors having to work courts. Some courts, we're having to bring people off the street to put in there. And I think, and I've said, and I've figured that with the lieutenant, 6 positions would level things out, I think, for us from having to draw people off the street, part-timers. Some of them we wouldn't need anymore.
Define off the street.
Do what now?
What do you mean by
patrol deputies, detectives, vice officers, special operations officers, etc.?
They are qualified individuals that have now retired, typically. Is that correct?
No. We're bringing people, when I say off the streets, I'm talking about our patrol deputies that are patrolling, our detectives that are, we have to have a body in there because the court, the law says the sheriff has to look after the courts.
County manager, Ms. York.
Can I just ask a question to her, John,
sure,
before she gets me? Okay, lap salaries. I know we've had a conversation about all the departments in the county. Like they get a set budget, how many officers or how many DSS or how many parks and rec, whatever they need, that's what they're doing. But we're not, because I know Bill's been real sharp on this about, if you can hire those people, good, come back over here and then we fund them. Because it's just like the teachers, they don't get a funded position unless they're in the classroom. You just have to be real careful with that. When you're talking with lap salaries, that adds up to being a lot of money, like what I'm hearing you say. Is that like a built-in cushion? Is there anybody that ever hires an outside service to do this job? And then all these people that are on the staff right now go into patrol or detention or whatever to really fill the sheriff's department staff? I'm just asking. I don't know, but it just seems like it just keeps adding and adding and adding because we're short. I hear pulling off the road, we're trying to hire with bonuses to go to bailiffs. We don't have bailiffs. We're going to give them bonuses to get them. Detention's always weak because it's one of the hardest jobs in the world. And when does it ever end? That's what I'm trying to figure out because it's just, It's every time we turn around, and I know that's just what this game is when it comes to social workers. It's just a nightmare sometimes, and you have to have safety. And I'm just asking, is it cheaper to hire a company to be the bailiff staff for our courts and take those officers and put them inside the sheriff's department? Or is that even possible? Or is that just me just trying to figure out somehow how to fix this? What is the deal?
Ms. Short, before you answer that, Mr. Sheriff, I understand they have to be qualified and meet certain credentials. You can't just hire off the street, can you?
No, sir. No, sir. And I will tell you this, and I will reiterate this every day that I live. I will not hire some people that's going to be problems, has criminal records, or past history of violence.
Well, this an agency is vetted. You know, we need to vet people all the time when it comes to stuff like that. We're sitting just like a roundup, 2 o'clock, everybody show up. I'm just asking a question. I don't know if anybody's ever done anything like this or it's just ridiculous.
We do look at contracting out services occasionally. It works for some of our departments, but because these are sworn law enforcement officers and you are required to provide courthouse security by state statute, we can't do a contract for that.
Okay, I'm just wondering. Just trying to
good idea.
Get we everybody do, feel we do look so at everybody's that in other staff places. Is really healthy and full. That's all.
Ms. Short, do you have a recommendation?
Well, we had looked at some options for trying to come up with some creative solutions for this. We don't like to fund positions in the middle of the year, but the sheriff and I have had some conversations that he really does not want to give up his vacant positions. So our suggestion was to reclass 3 of the vacant detention officer positions. So you're not increasing your number of positions, you're not adding any more additional funding to that budget. But he has hesitation in doing that because he doesn't want to lose those positions. And I can't promise that they would be restored in next year's budget. I can only make a recommendation to the then sitting board that we would put those back in. So the recommendation we had looked at was reclassing 3 positions for January, asking for an additional 3 positions in your fiscal year 26 budget, and to restore the 3 positions next year as well.
As I recall, the bonuses were for patrol officers, detention, were not for bailiffs. So we would have to amend our previous motion and directive to include bailiffs, is my understanding.
Well, wouldn't bailiffs be sworn officers, Sheriff?
Yes, sir, they would.
So therefore,
they have to be.
They would qualify.
Yeah, I don't believe we delineated.
We just say sworn and detention, so they do have to be sworn to be a bailiff.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And just one more thing, I'm sorry, John. What the sheriff is talking about, a consultant, sheriff's department, whatever that term is, when is that going to happen? Is that like soon, like now? You would ask for someone to come in to really analyze the whole department to see what we would really need as far as bailiff staff?
No, what the North Carolina Sheriff's Association has a group that will come in and do security check and assessment of all the courts going on, and then they will make a recommendation. This is what you need to have complete control of security in your courthouses.
Do you have any idea when that's going to happen?
Well, they said that January, they all the way to January, but they're going to try to work it in before then, because I told them, I said, hey, January 1st, we're going to have a ton of courts here in Alamance County. We need to know. So they're trying to work it out where they can come in here and do that.
Is that something that we need to wait? I don't like to wait. Y'all know that. But just have an outside opinion, sometimes we may need more than what we're thinking we do, or we may need less, but that's an outside, totally biased, totally being objective kind of thing. I'm just asking.
Ms. Thompson, the reason we sit and we've dug through this and looked at it, they may come in and say we need more, but we will do with 6 people, we can do what I want to do if we have to keep some of the part-time people there. We will be able to cover the courts.
It's also the 8-week requirement for the vetting of the candidates before he can put them into place that we were working against as well.
Is that evaluation coming because of your request? This board's request? Who's requesting
Chief,
this?
Chief Superior Court Judge Tom Lambert asked that I call the Sheriff's Association and get that done.
Thank you. Again, I'm sorry. Again, with your recommendation, we don't bust the budget. We do include the needed funds for the bailiffs if they are retained. And then we have the opportunity next June with the new budget to reassess. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Mr. Langley.
Oh, thank you, Chairman. Ms. York, I just wanted to verify that this is your recommendation for, you're basically saying that the budget amendment would be half of the 450?
Correct. And it would just be moving money from your detention funded positions over to the bailiff positions.
Thank you. And there would be available funds for the sheriff to continue hiring detention officers between now and the next budget.
There would be. He would need to come back to the board for his additional 10 positions for the sign-on bonuses as he continues to fill those positions.
Because I heard Ms. Crawford say $1 million in lap salary.
Yes.
So that's our extension that we could get to. And Sheriff, to hire detention officers, roughly you said around 50?
Yes, sir.
So there would be funds in there for him to continue hiring.
Correct.
And I think this board has indicated that if you fill the first 10, we gave you 10 more, and if you fill that, then I'm of the opinion you can come back again.
Well, he's asked for another 10 today.
Yeah.
That's what I'm asked for another 10 today.
Well, you've only filled four, or I think you said four of those.
14, so we have six left, but we have 13 people waiting right now that we're processing, and we need to be able to tell them if they can get the bonus or not.
Gotcha.
I had a thought, Mr. Chairman. The county's recommending 3 reclass with money coming out of lap salary. What I'm sitting here thinking, to address my concern about, are there too many in the request? We could establish 4 new bailiffs, new positions, allow the Sheriff's Department to reclass 2, if you choose. If you look at the report and determine you don't quite need 6, you might need 5, then you could on your own reclass 1. They'll give you 2 to reclass, 4 new positions, and then at budget time we can reassess the 2 positions as a reclass, which would not be that detrimental to your number of 56 hires. That's a suggestion. Money paid for at a lap salary, so it wouldn't be a budget impact.
Is that a motion?
Wait, hold on. Just curious, these lap salaries, what are all these jobs? Because obviously they're there, but they're not being hired. We're moving that money to like ASAP stuff. So what happens? Are you still trying to hire these things that are lap salaries? So what happens if you have a stampede of all these people that want to be these lap salaries? What's that coming from?
If that happens, the sheriff will have to come before you and ask for new positions, because you'll have taken that money and put it over here for the bailiff. So he will need additional funds if he ends up filling all of those positions and needs additional positions.
So if they're lap salaries, are they as crucial? I would think so. Anything that wears the badge is crucial.
They're crucial positions. It's just that we've been challenged to fill them.
It's Paul and Peter. We're robbing Paul to pay Peter.
Otherwise, you need to hit your fund balance and come up with new funding to fill to pay for these positions.
I really don't think you're robbing Peter to pay Paul in that.
I think both of them are broke.
These funds have already been appropriated.
I understand that,
John. We cannot touch them. If he fills all 50-some positions, then the money's already set aside to do that.
Okay.
So we're not taking money that is not appropriate. And I hope you fill every position.
Absolutely.
But along the way, if we're careful, then we don't have to shift additional monies from another area. Mr. Turner, is that a motion that you made?
I'll make that motion.
I will second it.
one more thing. When he comes back, not he, when the sheriff, comes back in here for the next round of $10,000 bonuses, where's that coming from?
He will still come from lap salary.
That lap salary, I need some lap salaries in my house. I'm just...
So it's just to be clear, it's two new positions and two reclass positions, that is the motion.
Four new positions and two reclass.
Oh, you wanted to do all six? I thought you wanted to wait until we got clarification on...
Well, the two that they could reclass is at their option, so if they determine that they really need them, then they can do that.
Okay.
And I don't think they need board action to do that. If they determine that they don't, that they'd rather have those staying in detention to plus those up, then they can make that too. It's a choice. At your discretion.
Sure. Oh.
But you get four additional, regardless.
Four additional.
Plus two if you want them.
Okay. What about, I'm looking at the detention spots, being able and getting money for 10 more people, because we have 13 on the board plus the positions for the bailiffs. Or what are we looking for?
Right. Do you want to include that, Ben, on the motion, the additional sign-up?
I'd say let's do separate motion. I'd say let's cover this one and then roll it out.
Because it's done twice. We've had two rounds of $10,000, so correct. This is the third round
correct.
That we're talking about.
But that's not his motion yet.
I know. I'm just getting ready for it.
So the just to clarify, four, but two additional at a later time.
Four new positions with two additional that the sheriff at his discretion
could
reclass on his own if he chooses.
Okay. That
the board could then adjust next budget cycle.
Let me get this clear. You're saying four additional positions, and if they need two more,
it's your discretion if you want to reclass two more.
Reclass them from the detentions.
Yeah, or whichever.
Yeah. Or officers or anywhere else you wanted.
And, Sheriff, I would just reiterate, when you and your captain start hiring these folks, send us an email, let us know progress here, because we know now that it's 14 to 16 folks. Just keep us updated on how these things roll in so we can sort of keep track of where we need to be or where we need to go.
Okay. So you're saying four new positions, and I can reclass two. What about the additional 10 that's on the board?
I think the chairman's going to take care of that next.
Oh. All
right. That's not on the deck yet.
I just called for the question.
Everyone in favor of this motion signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anybody opposed? Unanimous. Okay. That gives you six bailiffs if you choose to do so.
I understand, and I appreciate everything that y'all are doing.
Now, as to the 10 additional positions you've hired, is it four or six?
We've hired 14 of the 20 for the 10.
So you still have six to go?
Yes, sir. But we have 13 people that we're processing right now for detention and one for sworn. So that's 14 people that we're actively processing that we've done background. The next thing for them to do is to go to FMRT to get their medical, their drug, and their psychological. So we need to be able to advise them on whether or not they're eligible for the sign-on bonus.
And out of all that, how many are detention?
Of those 13 are detention, yeah. And one is sworn.
Okay.
More of the money's there.
It is getting us a lot of interest, yes.
The deferred or non-used thus far salaries.
We're looking to hire these 10, at least 10 of those on November the 18th, and then we'll have another set of swearing in on December, the early part of December.
And we have another meeting before the 18th, so we could defer this specific issue to our next meeting, or we could go ahead and do it.
I'll make a motion that we approve the request.
Yes, ma'am.
One more question. If you hire officers from a city police or way out in the something like that, do they have to go through all, if they're already on the force, and they're driving a car or they're doing whatever, do they just walk right in?
No, ma'am.
Or do
the
they
statute,
have to go through all that stuff?
The statute requires for sheriff education and training standards. Yeah. That's if they're already sworn, they do not. But the sheriff makes us go through the entire process to include going to look at any law enforcement agency they've worked. We look at their personnel file. We go out to their community. We talk to every last one of their jobs to see if they're eligible for rehire. So we don't differentiate. We keep the process fluid and consistent to make sure, because we don't know this officer, and we need to make sure we're getting a good quality officer.
Okay, just wondering.
I do have one question. I'd like to ask Ms. Crawford. Since you're our budget director. You mentioned earlier that it's possible that his budget could go over.
Yes.
So, you know, and I'm referring back to lap salaries again, because I don't want to, I want to get close, but I don't want to go over. This extra 10 positions I think is needed, but wouldn't that come from lap salaries?
It would, and I think that's part of the danger of what we're talking about, is that historically the sheriff's positions and the detention positions have not been fully filled, meaning we have carried large numbers of vacancies. That trend does seem to be changing by having these sign-on bonuses, which I look at as a really good problem. Sure. When I think about our budget, I would prefer to use existing funds now and then come back to you in late April or early May if we need to add additional funds to that department budget as a whole, meaning we are balancing lap salaries across each division.
Right.
And that is a danger, but I see that as a really good danger, because that means that we have shifted to being able to fill vacancies on a regular basis. And so then we have a better idea of what is the true budget for the sheriff's department.
Can you tell me how many? I just can't remember. Can you tell me how many positions we budgeted for the sheriff this year?
I can't at the moment, but I can certainly get that back to you.
I know we froze some positions.
Right now, we actually have 23 budgeted. That's open, 6 marshal and 15 ICE. That equals 43.
Gotcha. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.
We did add a vacancy rate, meaning we took into account that there would be a certain dollar amount that would be left on the table. And so if we are able to successfully fill these positions this fiscal year, I anticipate next fiscal year we would decrease that vacancy rate.
Right.
So again, this is that exercise of trying to find what is the actual amount that we need if we are fully staffed.
Excellent. So you just said a true budget. So why don't we know a true budget? Or well, haven't we had a true budget with any department?
Sure. I think COVID was really difficult in terms of hiring. We know that there were a lot of resignations. We just had a hard time filling positions. We know we are fighting regionally across all departments because there's a shortage, especially in public safety and human services staff. So we, in our largest departments, we anticipated that based on history. But those trends are changing. And it's possible we can go back to what trends looked like 5 years ago in terms of staffing. And that's what this year is, a healthy year to do it. I'm kind of excited.
That's so Bill comment. I'm so excited.
Yeah.
I just watched him go, yeah.
And additionally, in law enforcement, those are very, very special people. Not just anybody can be a law enforcement officer, and not just anybody will do a good job in that position. And that's why you're so careful in reviewing and choosing the correct personnel.
You're absolutely correct. And if we have to work short the rest of my career, I'm not going to hire just anybody to wear that badge.
And we appreciate that.
Absolutely.
I know, as important as it is, because the whole world is helping right now, because our whole world has been shaken in our mountain and other states as well. We can't forget one street that's been damaged. Does it put you at does it put you in a tough situation when you go up there and take, because I know you're taking your best, because all your people are your best. Does that put you at a shortage? What am I trying to say? You know what I'm trying to say.
We work it out. A lot of volunteer time is given. And we work it out. Anybody that goes up, you're talking about to the mountains,
yeah.
FEMA reimburses the county for their salary, and they go up because they want to help people. It ain't that they want to make money, because if you've been up there, you couldn't pay me enough to stay up there a month. I can tell you that when you're pulling bodies out of mud and stuff like that.
It's a real war.
It is. It is,
and ma'am. Sheriff, FEMA is reimbursing the county for everything, including even mileage.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So taxpayers, and we're helping out
Alamance,
all those counties in the mountains, but we're not paying for it out of tax dollars. But the sheriff, local with his wisdom, is doing it for the benefit of our neighbors.
Yes, sir. And I am so proud of the citizens of Alamance County. We're going to be taking 3 tractor-trailer trucks up this coming Friday to somewhere in the mountains.
That's great.
I'm proud of Alamance County people.
I make a motion to approve the request.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any further comments from board members and or staff? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? You've got 10 more.
Thank y'all very much. Thank you.
Now, film them. Thank you, sir. Okay, 7B. Well, correct. Mr. Carter corrected me. He said FEMA is tax dollars. That's correct, but it's not county tax dollars.
Right.
I've been corrected. Item 7B was removed from our docket. We're now down to 7C, and Mr. Baker.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm before you again to talk about construction delivery and bidding methods this morning. We've been doing this a little bit over the past few meetings, talking about the various ways that we're able to bid projects. I'm not going to belabor all these because we've gone through them in recent meetings, but I do want to focus on the design build method. So last meeting we approved a project as construction manager at risk bidding, and we I think have a project that would be a good choice for a design build bid. So in a design build, you are essentially hiring one company to be responsible for all phases of the construction. So they design the building, they build the building. If it costs too much, it's their fault, and you've got one person that answers to you for getting this project done. That's a big benefit. Another benefit of this method is because you don't have to do repeated bidding, it can get done more quickly. You do the bidding up front, and after that, you just go get the job done. So design build offers you some cost certainty. It offers you a little bit more speed. And in certain circumstances, I think that's appropriate. One of those is the elderly services building renovation that we've authorized. So this is a project that needs a design, although it's not an extremely complicated design because we have the shell, but we still need to go in and figure out what that renovation looks like. We're also in a bit of a hurry to get this done so that we can shift people around. And we have decided a set dollar amount to get this done. Doesn't mean that we can't come under. We can still come under that amount as we get in there and figure it out. But we know we don't want to spend more than $5 million on this.
And Mr. Baker, that's the building we removed inspections and planning and which other services into?
Right. And also environmental health. Some portion of environmental health we haven't quite figured out if the building's going to hold them all. But the point is to create a one-stop shop for contractors and the public to go get all their permits in one location. So we'll be able to do that here.
Thank you.
So I think for the reasons that we've mentioned that this is a good candidate for a design build bidding process. So part of the problem though is we've never done a design build process, and so we don't have some of the infrastructure in place. So what I'm asking you to do today is really a two-step process. You first have to adopt a design build resolution. Statutory process, you've got to pass this resolution that says we can do this. We are allowed to do design build. We've decided we can do this. And then you need to use those criteria to evaluate this particular project. So the resolution is in your packet. I hope you had a chance to look at that. It just says we as a county think we can do design build for some projects. And then the criteria that you're using to decide if this is a good one is whether we can define the project requirements, are there time constraints for this project, can we deliver a quality project, just the things that we've been discussing this morning. So happy to talk about this process and whether this project is a good fit to do design build. But at the end of the day, if we decide that we do want to do this, we need two motions. We need to design the adopted design build policy and then select the design build method for this project. So do you have any questions about this?
How does the bid process work if we approve the design build?
Yeah, so we put out a request for proposals from companies. We gather all those and pick the company that we want to work with. And we then negotiate the price and the project price with them. And we go through that entire process with them. So there's still a competitive bidding component, but it really comes on their end because they then are bidding out all the subs by prices. And so there's still a price aspect to this. But up front, we are choosing a company and a price all at one time, and that's what we're going to try and make it.
Is the price for a specific scope of work?
Yeah, so it's really hard to get that right. Particular price. We're going to say, here's the project budget, okay. Right? And then as we get through the design, if we then say, well, we want a swimming pool, that's going to change the price. But we're going to be upfront about what our project budget is and where we're trying to hit, and we're going to pick the company that we feel confident can deliver it to us for that price.
It also means with the jail construction and with J.B. Allen, we had litigation because everybody said, oh, that leak or that defect was his fault or her fault or whatever. This narrows it down to one simple entity, and there is no finger pointing.
Yeah. They can finger point to each other all they want with their subs, but we're not involved, and that's exactly. A huge benefit.
Yeah, over the years I was in finance, I've done a number of projects with my clients that were design build, and they all went a lot smoother.
Brian, how long do you think it'll take from start to finish?
So the folks that I've had out there have told me they think 12 months from the date that we start. So obviously we've got to bid it. That doesn't start today. We got to bid it. We got to pick a company. We got to say go. But we think 12 months from there. Like to do a little bit better, but that's a reasonable scope.
Absolutely. I agree.
How long will it take to bid it?
Oh, you know, to get a bid in a contract, 6 weeks, 6-8 weeks.
So we're looking at 14, 15 months.
Yeah.
Question. Okay. Just an overview. You're going to be doing this building because you're taking something out of this building over here to add the what's going in that building over here where the planning and the veterans and all that.
County annex. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Giving that to the court system.
Okay.
And then the people that are in there need a place to go, and so we're moving them to the elderly services building.
Okay. So you're going to be, that's a temporary fix because waiting on the impending courthouse to be built. After that's built, what happens to that? It just goes back like it is and you pull out what you put in there or what?
No, we would anticipate that continuing to be part of the court system after that. So we don't know exactly what it's going to be. It's a few years away. So in the meantime, while we're building the courthouse, we're going to use it as flex space. As we displace people and are renovating their space, it's going to be they can go there for a while their space is being worked on. After that, I think the court's going to continue to need it because all of the people who want to be in the new addition are not going to fit in the new addition. So I think that we'll...
They're not going to fit in the new addition.
Not everybody in the world is going to fit in the new addition, so it will allow us to maybe recapture some of this space.
Gotcha.
The original plan was we can get some of this space back to alleviate county needs. So ideally, we could move some of those folks into the county annex building, but we'd consider it court space from here on out.
But once they're in this building, the elderly services building, they're not going anywhere else. That's permanent home.
Correct.
I'd caution the word permanent.
Well, for millions of dollars, it needs to be permanent, at least for a while.
Yeah. Okay. In the foreseeable future.
Right.
Mr. Turner.
Probably needs a different name.
Than old elderly services building? Agreed. I hate to change name midstream, or you guys won't know what I'm talking about. But
the building probably needs a new name. I would move that we approve the resolution authorizing the use of design build.
Second.
And this price will be on top of the estimated price to hire these people.
Or this is the same money that we talked about at previous meeting. So no new money today, just how we spend it.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments by commissioners before we take the vote? I would add that by moving planning inspections, environmental and so forth into one location on Martin Street, that puts everybody, contractor, homeowner, whomever, goes to one location instead of all over the county.
Right. Does that mean, since Mr. Russell's here, does that mean you're going to move next door when it gets completed, or are you going to stay where you were?
It depends on if they can fit us all in there.
Yeah.
We're talking about it.
I got a few wants and needs.
Yeah. She had an extensive list.
Excellent. Thank you.
All in favor of this motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
I oppose, no.
All right, have 4-1. Ms. Thompson opposes.
I move that we select the design build method construction for revamping the elderly services building.
And that is the resolution that was in our packet, correct?
So what you just passed, I think, was the design build resolution authorizing us to do that. I think now the motion Mr. Turner has made is to select this method for the elderly services building.
Thank you. Any further comments as to this motion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Again, 4-1, Ms. Thompson opposes. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Next, we would go to the county manager. But if the board would allow me, we have two interns. What questions do you have of this board? Have you learned anything by sitting here? Did you gain a couple of hours of knowledge, or did you waste your time?
Thanks, Thomas.
Thomas is answering for
you. He's just old and crudgy.
I definitely think I learned a lot. I've never really even sat in on any court proceedings, so between seeing civil court and this, it's a lot. It's really good to be in the community. Thank you.
Same. I would say I learned just how the whole system works and how we work as a community.
And I would also like to add, you have so many different levels of government. You have the federal, executive branch, the legislative branch, judicial, and that's up here, and then you have the state level, and you have all kinds of additional levels and hearings and boards and so forth there. And then you come down to the county, and we largely govern Alamance County. We don't have anything to do with Guilford or Orange or the cities, municipalities. So you've learned today, hopefully, a good civics lesson.
Yes, and as social workers, both of them have to learn, you know, how systems work and how we're affected. And as a county department, they know we are affected heavily by what happens in local politics. So
What school?
I'm at Elon.
I'm at UNC Pembroke.
Okay. It's always good to get out of the classroom and really get saturated in the community, because what you're in is really serious work. Thank you. Don't ever quit, because the world needs you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. I did my undergrad at Elon.
Oh, awesome.
So a law school at Wake Forest. Elon did not have a law school when I became an attorney. So whatever. Mr. Turner, on the other hand, graduate of Elon Law School, Naval Academy undergrad, and Elon Law. So.
Yeah, I'm in my senior year, so I don't know where I'm going after this. But
it's
done. Excellent. More is better than less.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to give a big shout out to Tony. We were just, never mind. It was priceless. Isn't that right, Tony?
So folks were
private
confused.
Joke.
Folks were confused about my name. It's okay.
We're called different names no matter where we go.
The crowd in the audience, they lost me. Okay.
Just had to be there.
County manager.
Commissioners, I wanted to highlight some of the efforts that Alamance County is doing to help support Western North Carolina. In addition to the three tractor trailers of supplies that are heading up this Friday, we have about four of our employees who are deployed. We have our emergency management director, Chris Saul, our emergency management coordinator, our health director, and a 911 telecommunicator, who are all working in different parts of Western North Carolina, doing shelter work, cleanup work, all different, assessing all needs that they can help with. So we wanted to mention that. We also have had deputies in teams of 4 to 5 being deployed for a few days here and there. They're going to Burnsville and Yancey County. And then we've also shared two utility terrain vehicles and the Bearcat from the Sheriff's Office as well. So we will keep you posted as our efforts continue to roll out to help support this part of our state.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Great news.
And I personally have in Ken Folks, Mr. Turner, you have court?
I do. Excuse me.
All right. Thank you. Having relatives that live in the Blowing Rock Boone area, I really appreciate everything that not only Alamance County, but the whole country's doing for those folks. Help is needed desperately. Entire roads have and bridges have washed away along with homes, industry, and so many folks, so many lives lost. So our prayers and thoughts are with them. Thank you, Alamance County. Anything else?
Nothing else.
We're shifting around county commissioners' comments because the county attorney has a closed session that's required. So Ms. Thompson, county commissioner comments.
Yeah, just really quick. Eastgate Global Magnet School in Marion, North Carolina. That's where our health director is in McDowell County. I toured their school a couple years ago and I was on the board, and they had a large meth epidemic in that area, and a lot of kids in that school were open DSS cases. And I think I've told you guys they had a golden retriever by the name of Leroy that was a therapy dog that constantly served these children. And I was real concerned about this school. When I talked to Tony, he said that the schools in McDowell fare pretty well. They'll be open on Wednesday, which is so good. But if you have a opioid crisis or anything else, it's a really even worse situation for you because of just the stress. We saw what addiction skyrocketed when it was COVID. I also emailed via our Donald Roos the day that all this with Asheville, and I could not get in touch with him. I was concerned about him, and I also met Deborah Bechtel because I knew she was in another county that kind of got hit hard too. Deborah said they were going to a motel, they were okay, but I didn't hear from Donald Russo yesterday during church. And he said he finally got phone service and he was able to text me, and he just said, we got a mess up here. For somebody that works with that kind of situation, a mess is a big word coming from him. So I just encourage us all to pray for our very people that are working in the crisis situation without a hurricane. And I had asked, this may seem petty to some of you, but it didn't me, I had asked about whenever we had the school shooting hoax the other week and two juveniles were arrested. I met with Dr. Harrison, and he said almost 6,000 kids were out of school that day because of fear and just the pull of fear. Fear is so powerful. And not one shot fired, but look at the results of it. And I had asked about our commissioners, because when I was on the school board, we had a budget. We would provide lunch sometimes with our work sessions and things like that and trainings and all. And I wanted to know if we could do a lunch for those officers that work that thing 24/7 to find those two juveniles that what are they thinking? There's never a later with young people, and they're really in a lot of serious trouble. And I wanted to give a luncheon for these folks that worked tirelessly to make sure not one shot was fired on ABSS's campuses. It was said no because we don't have that budget. And I know that's I know what money is. We just have money, capital fund. We have $100,000, all that. But I think stuff like this is real personal and real important because we talk about how important our law enforcement is, our EMS, our everybody that does first responders. Sometimes we just need to get in a room sometimes and just kind of de-escalate the situation, just sit around with a meal and talk about it. I think it's very important. So I hope sometimes we can really, really look at things like that to make a difference. And with our diversion center, I got a call about how some of the folks for the diversion center, they're going to the diversion center, are going over to the daycare, which is operated by Cone, that has hospital kids there, and they're going and wanting to come in because they're getting confused with which building it is. They're smoking a fence line and things like that. So it's something we need to really look at to not have any kind of daycare worker. The director has been in there for 16 years, and she mentioned that they were really nervous about this. That's a very tough population, no matter where you are, what you're doing, but I hope we can really figure out some way to, that's a great big building with a great big sign, to make sure that our folks are going to the diversion center and not getting confused somehow to the next building, which is a child care services. We just need to have safety with no matter who it is we're dealing with, and that's about it.
Ms. Thompson, do you have the address for the behavioral health center for those in TV land and those in the audience?
I don't. It's on Kirkpatrick Road. That's all I know.
It's right behind the IHOP. So if you're going down Huffmanville Road, make the left-hand turn at the traffic light and then go behind IHOP.
Behind that Circle K.
And you're right, it's a circle drive. Make the right-hand turn on Kirkpatrick, and it's right there on the corner. And it's actually two, as Ms. Thompson pointed out, two buildings. The primary, largest building is the Behavioral Health Center, but they have a separate building for the youth or juveniles. And that's essential because you don't want to mix adults and kids and their needs and their tragedies.
Thank you, Ms. exactly. Children in a daycare. We just need to make sure we're real clear about where folks are supposed to be going, because anytime you move, there is confusion. I mean, you know, you just got to figure out where you're located at.
Thank you for your comments.
The address on that is 963 Kirkpatrick Road in Burlington.
Thank you. And it's right there at the Circle Drive. It's easy to find, but you got to go behind the aisle. Mr. Turner's left for court. Mr. Lashley.
Thank you, Chairman. I don't really have a whole lot. I just want to make a public service announcement since we're in the month of Halloween. The Alamance County Sheriff's Office is going to have a trunk or treat on Tuesday, October 29th, between 5:30 and 8. Really need some donations for candy. And this is for Thomas, because I know you'll donate some candy to us. you can donate this candy to Alamance County Sheriff's Office, Alamance County offices here on 124 West Elm Street, or the YMCA, which is on Main Street, 11346 Main Street. Just thought I'd let people know that, because I know that it's a time of year that kids like myself like lots of candy, so I want to make sure we can support them with it. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Carter.
So you know when you back clean up, there's a lot already off the table. So. I made a note earlier to make a comment about what Ms. Thompson just covered, that the potential issue there between the daycare and the behavioral health center proximity, and the question I have for management though, have we worked out a situation with the security there yet?
Terry, do you have an update on that?
So we're still working on that. They are utilizing the sheriff's office right now and having conversations with municipal police departments about using off-duty officers. So I believe that will be the route that we go, but it's still not 100% worked out right now. But they do have 16-hour-a-day coverage at the moment.
Okay. That's another potential issue with the sheriff's office. If we have to take that on as an agency for the sheriff's office, then mm-hmm. that's a couple of more head count probably to that covered 24 hours a day, because it's a 24-day, intended to be a 24-hour-a-day operation, so don't
forget. And that's true. When I was on Jack and Jeff Smythe was police chief, that was, they really had that worked, where, because this is for a county, it's a county program. That means not everybody comes from one street that has crisis issues, and we all need to cover that. It just needs to be done. We all need to cover it, because no matter where that person comes from, there has to be security at that place, because you don't know what's fixing to walk in that door.
That's
and
right.
You've got to be prepared for it. So yeah. You have coverage in the emergency room. This is like a mental health emergency room, and everybody needs to chip in and do this. This is why it was built, and we got to all stand up for it.
Well, we still have an issue at the hospital in the emergency room area with boarders. I've brought that up and discussed it here in the past. There's still a large number. There's one area, I've forgotten exactly what they call it, psychological health or whatever, that has about a half dozen youth that have been boarding in there for a long time. They don't have any place else to put them.
That's not what your emergency room does.
Right.
It is not that.
Not what they do.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, it is what they're doing.
Well, we built this diversion center, and it needs to get going and be safe.
Well, if municipal agencies would take a look at the fact that when they send somebody deliver somebody to the diversion center or the behavioral health center, if they deliver that person and we don't have a deputy in there, then they have to leave an officer there until that person is situated. And we do have security there. And it just kind of blows my mind that they don't want to participate with us and help make that process work on a 24-hour-a-day basis. They have more problems, from what I understand, than we typically have from the rural parts of the county. It's coming more from our municipalities than it is from the rural parts of the county. So municipalities need to step up and be a part of the solution instead of part of the problem.
Let me explain to you what the behavioral health center is. Sky already knows. Behavioral health center is a new facility, just having been completed and just opened at a ribbon cutting a couple of months ago. And it's run by VIA, which is our Medicaid service provider. Ms. Thompson talked about VIA and their chairman and their local representative, Donald Reese, and so forth. They're based in Asheville. Boone, Blowing Rock, all those areas had real devastation, but Asheville probably saw as much or more than anybody else. So that's where they are based, where they live, and thank goodness they have provided to us now this new behavioral health center. And that's a center where individuals that are picked up by law enforcement because of whatever reason, misbehavior, uncontrolled behavior, drug, alcohol, addiction, whatever the problem is, or by EMS, emergency services, or family members or themselves want to get help, short of going to the Alamance County Room and Board, i.e. jail, don't want to go there, and or the emergency room right off from the get-go, can go to this new center. We have up to 16 beds, so they can do short-term housing of individuals. You don't want to go above 16, because the federal government makes you become a hospital if you go over 16, that's why the number. And then if they're there short term in one of the housing facilities, they can then be placed to a longer term facility and get longer term help and hopefully recovery. Having practiced law for over 50 years, I am of the firm belief that individuals that have a particularly drug and alcohol problems, if they want to be saved and are willing to seek out Savior, that is help, then they can be saved. But I'm also equally convinced that if they don't want help, that's why you have so many homeless people. They don't want help, they aren't going to go to the shelter and so forth. because they have to follow the rules there. So somehow we've got to convince part of our population that they've got to seek help, and this behavioral health center is one way to do that. Mm-hmm. Now, county attorney.
Thanks, board. I've got a couple of closed session motions for you today. The first, pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11a3, I ask the board move into closed session to consult with an attorney employed or retained by the public body in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the attorney and the public body. The attorney will advise the board on ongoing legal matters, including the national prescription opiate litigation matter. Second, pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11a6, I ask the board move into closed session to consider the qualifications, competence, performance, character, fitness, conditions of appointment, or conditions of initial employment of an individual public officer or employee or prospective public officer or employee. I don't anticipate any action after the closed sessions today.
I'll move that we go into closed session unless you have additional information.
That's it. Thank you. That's the two I propose.
All right. We have a motion and a second to go into closed session. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We're now in closed session. We will come back at the end of the closed session and conclude the meeting. Now, since we have nothing to report, do we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Oh, that's right. So moved.
We have two motions and no second. Mr. Carter made the motion. Mr. Lashley made the second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Commissioner meetings typically occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. The first Monday meeting begins at 9:30 a.m. and the third Monday meeting begins at 6:30 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting will be broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about their schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/AlamanceCountyNC or by clicking the YouTube link on the county website. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of this meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about the commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.